everybody, it's Spaz, and thank you for tuning in to In the Think Tank with Spaz. Today, I want to talk about, and I'll make this quick, I want to talk about the Beatles. Now, of course, oh my God, everybody knows everything about the Beatles, huh? That's right, you do, don't you? Well, you know what? When we were kids, and this is what I'm going to do, I'm going to talk about the Beatles from the viewpoint of a kid, being a kid and loving the Beatles. I grew up with the Beatles. My folks loved the Beatles, but my Aunt Lori actually saw the Beatles in 65, 66. We were like, whoa. But the Beatles were and are the single most important band in my life. They, you know, a lot of the music I listen to today is informed by the Beatles' music, by the Beatles' influence. You know, we all love the Beatles, and in the previous video I talked about connection. There's that connection between a lot of Beatles fans. I mean, some people are obsessive, maybe over-obsessive of the Beatles. But, you know, I was obsessive of the Beatles when I was growing up. I remember going to the Orange County swap meet and getting bootlegs of Live at the Hollywood Bowl, and this is... Gosh, must have been 75, 76, something like that. It was before the Hollywood Bowl actually was officially released by Capitol. But it was such an important, oh my God, the Beatles live. Of course, the thing I remember most about that album is the fact that we were looking at the track list. And of course, back then, bootlegs were just this white sleeve and they had a... like a Xerox piece of colored paper that was shrink wrapped onto the white sleeve. And I remember reading the tracks and going, oh my gosh, they do the song called Falling in Love. Oh my gosh, amazing. Falling in Love. I've never heard it. It's a Beatles song I never heard of. And of course it ended up being If I Fell. So, you know, bootleggers were well known for getting song titles wrong. But being a kid, I was really super into the Beatles. My brother and I, we had books. My brother's got a lot of most of them. We never really had a new Beatles album growing up because basically my folks would buy, you know, Beatles 6 or something new. And, you know, they'd play it and we'd love it. And then the next Christmas, oh my God, we got Beatles 6. We got something new. Fantastic. We were so excited. Well, basically it was just my parents giving us their copies of it, just wrapping it up. But we didn't care because it was the Beatles. You know, stuff like that didn't matter to us. What mattered to us was the actual gift, the music. So we got to listen to it. And, you know, we went to a Beatles convention. Now, I don't know if it was actually Beatlefest, but this is 1977. And there's two things I remember about that. I remember seeing a short film, like an anthology type film called The Long and Winding Road. That was like a precursor to the actual Beatles anthology. And it looked like, you know, maybe they created this as an intro or they created this as to shop around to say, hey, look what we can do. We can combine all this Beatles archive footage and make a documentary out of it. And it never happened. But, you know, that was the only time I remember ever seeing that footage of a projected film called The Long and Winding Road. Second thing I remember about that convention was being preached to outside of the lobby while we were waiting for our dad to pick us up, and some lady was asking if I knew Jesus, and I'm thinking, I mean, I've heard of him, I haven't met him, but I mean, I was 13 years old, so I didn't know what she was talking about. Anyway, let's go back a little further. When we were growing up, you know, the Beatles were everything to us. I remember going to my grandma's house, and my Aunt Lori had Abbey Road, and we were, oh my God. I mean, I was begging her, oh, can I have this album? It's like I didn't realize that everyone else liked the Beatles as much as me and my brother did. But that connection to my past is very important, you know, to my family, to the feelings I had, to the joy and stuff that music gave me, that the Beatles music gave me. And I think that's why so many people connect on the internet here. And, you know, we all watch each other's videos, but the Beatles tend to be the most popular thing because that's the band that people are most passionate about. And it all starts in youth. And it usually starts in, you know, what point did you get into the Beatles? We got into the Beatles because, I mean, we were growing up. I was alive and I was conscious of the Beatles while they were together. But of course, I didn't realize they broke up until 73. I guess my parents were, you know, oh, shouldn't tell the boys, you know, don't spoil the boys. But, you know, like I said, I wasn't really exactly sure if we really, really understood that. I remember bringing the Get Back single, kindergarten, show and tell, and putting it on, and the teacher saying, oh, that's the Beatles? I didn't know that was the Beatles. And it's like, I'm going, oh, well, I knew it was the Beatles. Of course, I had the single. Actually, I borrowed it from my mom. But the one thing that I, you know, I don't want to get way too deep into this because I'm trying to keep these videos short, but I wanted to tell you about one thing, and I'm sorry, I may break out laughing, but this is a legendary story in my, I don't know if it's really my family, but, you know, definitely between my brother and I and our friends, and that's something that we call the Ringo fart, okay? Basically, what the Ringo fart is we were probably 5 or 6 years old, right? And we were big fans of the Beatle cartoons. And if anybody remembers, Ringo in the cartoons would always go, yeah, right? So I think one day my parents are having a party or whatever. And I think at the time my brother and I had a bunk bed. You know, we were sleeping in bunk beds. I think I always had the bottom and he had the top, or I don't know what it was. So we're laying in bed, and my brother and I we're about 11 months apart in age, so he's probably 6 and I'm 5, and laying in bed. And of course, being young little boys, you know, you gotta, you know, toot, and you giggle at it. Well, we're laying in bed one night, we're both wide awake, and all of a sudden I decide to, well, you know, let the sphincter scream, so to speak. And of course, it came out, and it was, and it sounded exactly like the Ringo cartoon. So here I am in the bunk bed, and my butt is talking, and it's saying, and my brother and I cracked up so much, and we continue to tell the story, and I'm surprised I can get through. I'm trying to be a little more serious now. I mean, how serious can you get when you're talking about a fart? I don't even talk about this stuff publicly, but I told myself, you know what? I'm going to go on YouTube and I'm going to talk about the Ringo fart because it is now legendary amongst friends. In fact, there are people that even before I met them, they would comment on Facebook or say something to me about, tell me about the Ringo fart, or you're the guy that did the Ringo fart. Oh, Lord, I don't even know. I might even cut this part out. But anyway, that's it. I just wanted to talk for a few minutes about the Beatles and about how important the Beatles were to us as kids. They're still very, very important. They're still my favorite band. They will always be my favorite band. But for the record, Old Brown Shoe was worthless to me. Oh, Lordy, Lordy, Lordy. That song is about as worthless as Revolution Number 9. I'm not a sycophant. I'm not going to sit here and tell you that everything that the Beatles do is great, because 99.9% of it is great. And there's just a couple stinkers. And but anyway, that's it. I thank you. Please share your comments with me. I appreciate, you know, I'm not trying to get anybody mad. I'm just trying to talk. I'm trying to connect to you. Connection is important. So until the next time we meet here in the think tank, my name is Spaz. Smell you later.